All right, hello everyone, welcome. We're having a forum today. What we have is a panel of people who are wallet developers, wallet experts, product managers, and we're going to be discussing light wallets, some of the pros and cons to light wallets, what are the advantages and disadvantages of a light wallet, and the different features of light wallets. And today we have Matthias, Sergio, Alex, Marcel, and Sebastian with us. All are experts in some way with working with Cardano blockchain, working with different types of wallets. And I'm going to be the moderator, so I'm going to moderate the process here. I think you're familiar with my background, so I'd like each person to tell us a little bit about yourselves. Let's start with Sergio. Can you tell us a little bit about your background and yourself, please?
Yeah, definitely. So my background really has been following the blockchain for the last five years. And recently, like over half a year ago, I joined Emurgo, where I took the lead of leading all the development of the products that we develop here. So I'm really managing all the products at Emurgo and, of course, Yoroi. Thank you.
Thank you as well. Alex, please.
Yeah, so I'm the product manager for wallets and services at IOHK. So I've joined IOHK for about 2.5 years ago and been in the blockchain space for about 5.
All right. Thank you, Alex. And often known as KTORS, Matthias?
Hey, so yeah, I've been working on Cardano for about 4 years now, mostly initially on wallets, then working with Alex on the Cardano wallet backend and, you know, assimilated services. And more recently, I've switched focused on Hydra and more on the research side, trying to bridge a bit some of the research work into the engineering, but still with a quite heavy focus on, you know, getting things in the hand of users in the form of wallets or anything.
All right, thank you, Matthias. And Marcel, please.
Hi, I'm Marcel. I'm CEO at Tastenkunst and Titan Proofstake operator. I started working in the space, in the Cardano space, 2019. And from that pool operation, we evolved a bit and are now working on a wallet, on a community wallet.
All right. Thank you, Marcel. And Sebastian.
Hey, my name is Sebastian. I've been in the Cardano ecosystem for about 3.5 years. Originally, I was part of Emurgo, where I was the co-VP of engineering, leading kind of the Cardano team. So at that time, I was leading the Yoroi wallet development. I was also working on specifications for Cardano related to wallets. And I was also leading the development of the REST SDK for Cardano that's used by most wallets today. Nowadays, I have my own company that I started with Robert Kornacki and Nico, who's also ex-Emurgo. And our core focus right now is trying to enable Cardano to talk with basically Solidity smart contracts. And that includes the full stack from being able to chain the smart contracts together to integration into wallets as well.
Awesome. Thank you, Sebastian. So we have the representation from different areas of the community here, Adrestia, Yoroi, Daedalus, and soon to be coming a form of Daedalus light wallet, and CC wallet, Cardano community wallet. So good representation here. And a quick summary that Alex and I had discussed prior to this recording was, what is this session about? So for the viewers, wallets have played a pivotal role in allowing crypto holders to safely store and access their digital assets. Daedalus and Yoroi brought ADA holders to the ability to stake and vote. And new community wallets are joining to compete. In the session, you'll learn about some of the innovative ideas that will inspire the wallets of the future. So with that said, let's get started into what we're discussing here. We touched on our background story. That was one of the initial, like, who's who in the zoo here. The next one is, should I stake my ADA on an exchange, and what are the pros and cons for using light wallets? And we don't have a specific format, so whoever would like to touch on that first, going into the pros and cons of why users should use wallets as opposed to exchanges, and what is the advantage of using a light wallet?
Well, I'll start with that one. That's an easy one. I think a majority of sort of like crypto enthusiasts will probably be very much against staking your ADA on exchanges. Like, you know, there's the old saying that, you know, not your private keys, not your money. And actually staking your ADA on an exchange, it's the exchange that is making the choice for you. So, you know, it's almost you're taking away your voting power and then your delegation power in this case. So I definitely personally wouldn't recommend doing it on an exchange. However, there's always the trade-off between full nodes and light nodes, where If you have a as we call it, a non-custodial, or you know, you have the private keys of your Light wallet, that can be like a very fast and light experience. While the full node wallet will be a more secure, albeit a bit heavier experience for the user. So yeah, it's dependent on what kind of user you are, really.
Yeah, and if I can add to that as well, if you don't mind. So one of the benefits of Cardano is that everything is done mostly on the base layer through the same kind of address scheme, which means that if you have your own wallet as opposed to having your ADA on an exchange, you can hold NFTs at the same time that you're staking. You can use smart contracts at the same time you're staking. So not only does taking your ADA off an exchange allow you to stake your ADA and get the rewards yourself, it also allows you to take advantage of all the other kind of features of the Cardano blockchain and the whole rest of the ecosystem. So, you know, this is the best thing to do. And at the same time, you know, if you take your ADA off an exchange, you can then delegate it to a single pool operator. And so you're helping to decentralize the network. And especially if you're a DeFi user, helping to decentralize the network is hugely important because that'll make DeFi applications on Cardano safer and faster as well.
Thank you, Sebastian. So can we go into what are the advantages of using a Light wallet as opposed to a full node wallet? And I got to tell you, one of my favorite full node wallet is, of course, Daedalus. I've used others like Emerald, but when it comes to full node, there's a little bit of a burden on the user. So what are the advantages to a Light wallet? Why would users want to use one of those instead of a full node?
Yeah, so one of the main advantages is just portability. You can take your wallet wherever you go. You don't need a strong computer. You can have it on your phone, on any kind of tablet device. And so that makes it much easier for users to use. You also have quicker access, so you don't have to wait until a synchronization. Usually synchronization on Light wallets is in a few seconds instead of hours. So these are kind of the main benefits. Now, see, the disadvantage is that you're kind of at the whim of the server that you're using. So for people who don't know, Light wallets mean that instead of downloading the full blockchain to your computer, it instead only downloads the transaction history related to you. So it means that you're trusting some server operated by whoever's operating the Light wallet to give you the correct data. Now, there are some ways you can kind of mitigate this. So for example, Yoroi, one of the things it does is that when it downloads the data from the Emergo servers, it actually stores it locally. So that even if the Emergo servers go down or whatever, you still have access to transaction history. If you want to sign transactions locally without internet connection, that's still possible. So you have, you know, Light wallets that, you know, kind of fully depend on the security of the server. Some Light wallets, you know, like Yoroi, kind of give you kind of a bit of extra, you know, data stored locally for convenience. And then IOHK is obviously working on research to improve this further. So you may hear about the research paper Mithril, which is a way to use Light wallets while still having better authentication of the data is accurate and that the server is not giving you inaccurate information about the state of the blockchain.
Thank you, Sebastian. And following up on that, can you tell us a little bit about CC Wallet and how CC Wallet helps the user interface for people to access their tokens on the blockchain, their native assets, and so forth?
Yeah, sure. We started as a normal wallet. We wanted to do all the basic stuff. And listening to our users and especially the Cardano NFT community, they wanted more features in a Light wallet, especially when it comes to displaying their tokens. Currently, before the start of smart contracts, those were mostly image-based or interactive tokens that are stored on the blockchain. And we give them the possibility to filter and search their NFT tokens conveniently in the wallet, and they can see what they have actually stored and can easily send multiple tokens and so on. So CC Wallet currently is mostly used by CNFT enthusiasts.
All right, thank you, Marcel. And I got to be honest with you, I used all three wallets. I have Daedalus, I use Yoroi, and I just started using CC Wallet. And I'll just go to one. I don't know why. I'll just say, okay, I'm going to go to this one this time, and I'm going to go to that one for some other reason. But thank you for that. And so next, can you, between Matthias and Alex, can you tell us a little bit more about the current state of Daedalus as a full node, and what are your plans for Daedalus Light node?
That is that's a good question. All right, so I mean, the current state of Daedalus is very much around you know, following the chain, making sure that you know, like, one, the correctness of the chain that you store locally, and making sure that these features that are becoming available in each of these eras are able to be used within within Daedalus. However, we are realizing that you know, like, the chain is becoming more and more used, there's more and more application on it, so what we call the chain density, or the chain users, is becoming higher, so it's becoming harder for a full node wallet on a regular desktop to follow the chain. So we are looking into various mechanics in order to make it easier, lighter, and higher performance, but at the same time we're also realizing that for the majority of the users, a full node wallet is not necessarily the best way to go forward. So for the majority of the users, we'll have a light instance of an IOG wallet, and we are thinking about perhaps using Daedalus as an enterprise track that we'll use for, you know, for larger institutions that are wanting to run operations on the blockchain.
I don't know, to be frank. I mean, Daedalus has, I mean, it's becoming heavier. Yes, it has to follow the chain and download everything. But on the plus side, it doesn't rely on any server, right? So that's still the nice part about Daedalus, which is that you connect directly to the Cardano network. And the main advantage of that is right, you don't need any server. But right, there are many scenarios where you don't really care about trusting necessarily the network, and you are just fine trusting a certain company servers to get the data from you. So there is a clear use case for light wallets in I/O, because we also want to build solutions on top of that, right? And with the smart contracts now arriving with the Alonzo era and all the things that is to be developed with that, it's easier to do that through light wallets and through either browser-based wallets or mobile apps than to do that with full-blown desktop apps. So for interoperability with, you know, all the dApps that are to come, there is a need to have also a light wallet solution. So yeah.
All right. So can someone tell me how the current light wallets work? What in the background provides the data for the current state of light wallet? Things like Cardano Scan, the Block Explorers. How does that work? And what are the plans for the future? What is that feature?
Yeah, so most wallets right now are running a tool written by IOHK's addressed team called Cardano DB Sync. And basically what it does, it looks at the state of a node, saves it to a database, and then the servers query that database. Now, the question is, how do people actually connect to this database? And there's kind of two main platforms being used right now. One of them is written by Emergo, and that's a kind of Cardano GraphQL wrapper, I believe it's named, the library. It's kind of a long one. And the other one is Blockfrost. So these are like the two main providers. So many different wallets out there are actually using Emergo's setup, and many wallets out there are using Blockfrost. So these are the two main providers. Not everybody wants to trust, you know, somebody else's server. So some people take the open source code and redeploy their own instance and connect to that. That's currently the state of things. So obviously, you know, as the ecosystem is growing, people are writing more ways to create light wallets, more ways to interact with the code base to kind of distribute, you know, who's in control of this, of the servers that where light wallets are getting their data from. And so that's where projects like Ogmios come in, which basically provide different interfaces with different trade-offs, and other wallets are now actually using Ogmios currently in production to get data for their wallet. So it's great to see kind of a growth in the number of libraries with different trade-offs and different servers being spun up, and different people building businesses off of, you know, running servers for users. And that's how people are connecting nowadays. Now, with the addition of smart contracts on Cardano, this actually adds a new dimension, because there's serving of just regular wallet data, which is, as I mentioned, has the existing, you know, two or three main solutions. But with the advent of smart contracts, now we also have to be able to serve smart contract information for wallets. And there's a tool by IOHK called the PAB, Plus Application Backend, that does serve this information, but unfortunately it's not quite well suited for light wallets at this time. It's more like a full node based application, but over time we'll see more and more tooling come out to help facilitate light wallets connecting to smart contract systems, just like we saw originally with Cardano. And during the initial release, there was only kind of one API for connecting to Light wallets, and now we're having a more rich and diverse ecosystem.
What are the advantages of Ogmios over DB Sync, and why would a developer pick one over the other?
That's a good question. And it's mainly a question of where you want to put the level of abstraction, right? So DB Sync, let's say, does a few choices for you, a few opinionated choices for you, right? It creates a database that has a certain structure and put everything in it. Then you have to query that database. But that's quite a heavy setup, right? You need to have a PostgreSQL database running, you need to have this whole syncing running, and you are kind of stuck with the database interface, right? If you don't like it, if you don't like the schema, you want something else, well, too bad. Ogmios is like something that sits at a much lower level because it mimics the current Cardano node interface, right? The nodes to communicate with each other or to communicate with DBSync or Daedalus, for instance. They have a specific protocol that we call the node-to-client protocols that have been designed in-house by the IOG networking team and that are, tailored for that particular purpose of streaming blocks from a node to a client. They are much lower level in the sense that they give you access to blocks, right? Raw blocks with all the information they have in it, headers, transactions, certificates, and whatnot. So then it's your job as a client application, consuming those blocks to filter them out and to drill inside the blocks to find the information you're looking for, right? So it's not necessarily structured in any similar way as a database. It's just a stream of blocks and you have to organize it the way you want. But at least you have the flexibility to organize it the way you want, right? So depending on the, I would say, the amount of knowledge you have and the amount of effort you want to put into organizing the data yourself, you might want to prefer one solution or the other.
You don't have to prefer one over the other. Sorry, just wanted to add to the whole setup thing. At CC Wallet, we use both Ogmios and DBSync. Ogmios for live data. It's just running alongside the node and querying the rewards from the stake addresses. And for all the history data, we do use DBSync currently. Yeah. So it's a good synergy. And I just want to thank everyone on this panel specifically for providing such good tools to the community.
Yeah, that's actually right. They are not necessarily competing tools. You can use both for different purpose, right?
Yeah. Same for us at the Murgo. At the moment, actually, we haven't been using Ogmios for a while, but we are now exploring it to have these, two sites where you can actually source the data and manipulate them in a different way. So that's something we're exploring at the moment as well.
Well, that's fantastic. So you have a both solution. That's nice to hear. And Sebastian had mentioned earlier, he brought up something called the Plutus backend. And there's another thing, the DAP connector, is that the same thing? And then getting back to the users, how does that help improve the user experience? So what is the DAP connector, Plutus backend, and how does that improve the user experience?
Yeah, so I mean, as Sebastian rightfully pointed out, like the PAB for Light Wallet isn't available yet. So having smart contract in a Light Wallet is currently not available. But if we do look at a lot of the setups, right? So the Plutus application backend is more the administrator of the smart contract rather than the executioner. The DAP connector, which is actually quite a nice tool, allows a Plutus application backends that are stored on a server somewhere to over the browser actually connect to a Light wallet, so a user can actually connect to DApps without actually having to run a Plutus application backend locally.
All right, thank you, Alex. Now, there are also other community wallets being built for specific dApps. There's the Jira wallet, Card wallet. Redodo, I believe, is building an app to interact with their smart contracts as well. So what is the best wallet currently for smart contracts? Is it Daedalus as a full node wallet, or are there light wallets available to interact with smart contracts for the users?
Yeah, I can talk about that. So the dApp connector that we have currently for Cardano is based off specification that me and somebody called Rob wrote back when we were at Emergo. And this dApp connector is written pre-Alonzo, right? So it means that the functionality available is kind of the core wallet functionality. And so people have already started taking this core wallet functionality, implementing it into their own wallets. And so that's why you see there's a few light wallets out there like Nami that have this kind of like basic support for very simple dApps. And that's what people are kind of integrating, playing around with. Now, obviously, this is good for dApps that don't actually require smart contract execution, but to support, you know, full smart contract support from a light wallet will require not only an iteration on the kind of Plus application backend and the support for that, but it'll also require an iteration on the specification for connecting dApps to light wallets themselves. Now, obviously, there's many companies interested in having this happen, and people have differing opinions on how this should be done. And so there's kind of a lively discussion in the Cardano Improvement Proposal repository about this topic. So if somebody's watching this panel says like, oh man, I'm building a dApp and I really need this functionality or I wish this was available, now's a good time to go to the SIP GitHub repository and voice your needs for your wallet, because we're currently, you know, talking about how to extend this specification for Alonzo's specific smart contract functionality.
So if I can add to that and try to answer your question, Rick, as well. Right, the dApp connector we just mentioned is more than being a tool. It's actually a standard, right? It's a standard which explains how wallet, how you could interface a wallet and a dApp. And what's the best wallet for doing a smart contract at the moment would be any wallet that is actually implementing the dApp connector. Because that means that ultimately you would get the same features that you would get in any other wallets that also implement this standard, right? That standard will evolve, as Sebastian said, you know, to provide all the necessary features for running dApps. So if your wallet also implement that standard, it means it's also compatible with a whole bunch of dApps that will be following that standard. So I would say that's the best bet. Stick with wallets that implement that standard and make sure, you know, to also contribute and voice features you need and things you want to see included in the standard.
That's an interesting feature. So if the dApp connector is being used on the back end of a wallet, it is possible for that wallet to display multiple dApps instead of having to use a different wallet for each different dApp. Is that what you're getting at?
Yeah, it's not really the wallet displaying the dApps. You can really see the wallet as a dApp itself, right? Let's get a bit meta. But it's just a way for the wallet itself to interact with other dApps, right? Dapps will need to spend funds at some point, right? The whole point of crypto and decentralized finance is to make transactions. So you want to spend money at some point. And the money is held by your wallet, which means that every dApp, they don't want necessarily to rebuild all the features, you know, the core features of a wallet, of managing your UTXO, signing transactions and whatnot. And you also don't want to trust every single dApp with your keys. So what you want to do as a user is to only trust one dApp, which is your wallet, to hold your keys and do things correctly, and then give permissions to other dApp to interact with your wallet, you know, to have access to your UTXO and to sign transaction that you have, granted, that you have allowed. And that's exactly where we're going, in an ecosystem where you have dApps which are just doing their dApp features, right? I don't know if it's an NFT dApp, maybe it's displaying NFTs, maybe it's allowing auctions on different NFTs. And at some point when you need to make the payment, well, it sends a request to your wallets via the dApp connector, right? And that request is making a payment of this particular amount, in which case you get, you know, prompted by your wallet. There is this dApp wanted to make this payment. Do you agree? Yes, no. And, you know, this whole interaction of things happens through the dApp connector.
Yeah, just to expand on that, Rick, so essentially this comes down to be like an integration or really like a bridge between the dApps and really the wallet, and really give operations to the dApps that they will go through the dApp connector if they are implemented in such a manner, right? So that really from a user perspective, what you will see is to allow or not to allow given actions that they are of course accepted through the dApp connector, right? So think it that way as a bridge or an integration or an API between the dApp and the wallet, right? That will implement that dApp connector specification.
You know, that's good to hear. It gives me a bit of a warm fuzzy because when it comes to security and authenticity of wallets, so what you guys are saying is, as long as I can trust the wallet, I don't need to trust the dApp with my keys. Now, the dApp is going to do whatever the dApp does. Could be a gambling dApp, could be a some type of loan borrowing dApp, whatever that is, and I don't need to necessarily trust that as long as I know what it does. I just need to trust my keys with the Light wallet in front of me. So with that said, how would myself as a user, how would I know a little bit more about the security of the Light wallet? How would I know that it's secure? Because that's a common attack vector that users have to face, is they get nefarious URLs that ask them to enter their private word seed, right? And then, you know, then they get compromised. So how does Light wallet security work, and how can I as a user be more assured in that I'm using the right Light wallet? What are some methods I could use?
Yeah, so one thing that is kind of the best way to solve this problem is to use a hardware wallet. So the benefit of hardware wallets is not only do you get the security, but you also get access to all wallets at the same time. One thing that's super tedious about using wallets is that oftentimes different wallets have different functionality. And so for one feature, you may want to use CC wallet. For another feature, you may want to use Yoroi, or you may want to use Daedalus. And for us at DC Spark, we're writing a wallet called Flint that's mostly focused on our sidechain. So we want the sidechain to connect, you know, Solidity style smart contract. And so if you want to call a Solidity style smart contract, you may want to use, you know, our specific tool. But, you know, having to maintain all these different wallet installs is sometimes a little tedious. But if you have a hardware wallet, you get automatic portability across all the different applications. No matter which application you launch, no matter which wallet you launch, you're always just pressing accept on the same hardware wallet, and you get the same wallet restored on every application. So hardware wallets are not only a great security feature, but also a great usability feature as well. Now, if not everybody has or wants to spend the money on a hardware wallet, despite the fact that it's not that expensive. And so if you have to use recovery phrases and you're, you know, not sure if you can trust this wallet, the easiest thing you can do is make sure you're downloading the right thing. You know, check user reviews, number of downloads, this kind of information. And also, as you're using a wallet, first try it with kind of a test recovery phrase and look at the network tab in your browser. So all browsers, Firefox, Edge, Chrome, come with a debug tool with a network tab. And if you look at that network tab, you can see what is getting sent to the Light wallet server. And so if you just restore kind of a dummy wallet just to test it out, you can see what is being sent to the server and decide based off the data it's sending and receiving whether or not this wallet they are testing out is actually real or if it's malicious.
Yeah, I think additionally to the hardware wallets, those are a great point. It comes like twofold here as well, which comes those that are more on the technical side, they could review the actual implementation of those wallets, right, if they are open sourced. So there is that always an alternative for new wallets coming out from the community. But for those that you know, are out there already and exist, the best method for anyone really about to download the different apps is to really to follow the formal and the real websites of the companies that are offering those wallets, right, to ensure that you download the correct one. And additionally to this, I think as all the communities should do an effort as well to improve the education about Cardano and what really, you know, that you shouldn't be sharing your recovery phrase and all this, right? So there is still an opportunity for the community and all the companies here to help with that education for anyone, any newcomer on Cardano, right?
Yeah, I like the idea of using the hardware wallets and also triple checking the URL, that you have the correct URL that you are using the wallet, the Light wallet on, right? Because those are all very important for user security. And the next part we were going to touch on was the different mobile or the different web browsers. I mean, so what are the different web browsers of compatibility? What's the best web browser to use with the current selection of Light wallets? For example, we have CC wallet. You know, does it work in Opera? Does it work in Brave? Or do you need to stick with the meat and potatoes of Firefox and Chrome? What do you guys think about the different web browsers, and how do you verify that? How do you get that compatibility with the different web browsers?
Nowadays we have quite a good compatibility between the browsers. I come from a background of online advertising 5 to 8 years ago, and it was a nightmare. Currently, they are all working on standards and following them through. And The only thing that we fight with is that is a problem is privacy browsing. So if the user selects to delete the cache of the browser on closing the website, then obviously all the locally stored data about the wallet is lost. But if they have their recovery phrase or just have their hardware wallet, they can easily pair it again with the Lite wallets, no problem. With CC wallet, we implemented a export in form of a encrypted JSON file that you can just store locally. So you don't have to deal with pairing or your mnemonic phrase again. You just load that file. You can have it in the cloud and load it on your mobile phone. So it's easy to move the wallet around to reuse it with our website. So even if you have Brave and it's getting rid of all the data on closing the tab, you can just easily import that wallet again. So that's how we circumvent this privacy feature.
Yeah, if I can add to that also, so there's kind of two main types of Lite wallets that exist right now. One of them are standalone websites. For example, CC Wallet is a standalone website, Adalite is a standalone website, and then there are browser extensions, such as Yoroi, for example. And so for browser extensions for like Yoroi and what Flint will be, is you have to actually download it from the Chrome store or the Firefox store. Now that means that to get these extensions updated, similar to Apple, similar to Android, you need to actually be approved by Chrome and Firefox. And sometimes they don't play nice. There's been many times where Yoroi was temporarily removed from either Chrome or Firefox. Other wallets in the crypto ecosystem have had the same issue, like MetaMask has had this issue as well. Gnosis Safe has had this issue as well. So with, you know, browser extensions, more than a compatibility issue, there is a certain, you know, gatekeeping issue, you know, with these platforms that can sometimes just choose to hide a wallet. From a functionality perspective, usually most things are supported across browsers. Usually the one thing that has trouble with cross-browser compatibility is hardware wallets. Because for a hardware wallet, you need to actually connect to USB devices or Bluetooth devices on your computer. And the different platforms don't like exposing this kind of functionality. Now, Chrome is the most open about exposing all your information, any opportunity, because, you know, Google can take advantage of that. And so they tend to be like the easiest to implement for, you know, hardware wallet support. But at the same time, they extract as much information as they can from your system through that. Other platforms like Apple and Firefox are more restrictive about what they allow apps to access and how they allow it to access. And so that causes more friction with hardware wallet devices and some functionality because that is not available in Apple and sometimes may not work that well in Firefox. But this is kind of the trade-off that was mentioned earlier between, you know, privacy and functionality.
Thank you, Sebastian. How do we see these wallets evolving, these Lite wallets running inside a web browser, whether it's with an extension or not? How do we see them evolving with smart contracts and the dApps? What are you guys doing moving forward to get smart contracts displayed so that users can interact with them inside the Lite wallets?
Yeah, so there's a lot of work going on Plutus, on the Plutus side to basically enable this. Now, the Plutus initial release was kind of a let's get something out the door. And so that's why it's only available for full nodes. We do have an internal plan at, and I say we as the ecosystem, like a plan of, you know, how to bring Plutus to Lite wallets. And so we know all the requirements, all the functionality that is needed, and those need to be built. So there's a certain amount of, you know, it's in the works, it's coming. But in general, there will be some friction due to the nature of Haskell code and the limitations of writing Haskell in the browser. And so we'll probably see a new kind of wallet come out as well, which is like a more of a hybrid between browser and desktop. So I wouldn't be surprised if we see in the future browser extensions that use, you know, browser extension specific functionality to allow connecting to applications that run your computer. And you can use this to basically run a smart contract execution framework on your computer that actually runs the smart contract and connect to it from your browser. So I think probably this will be one of the fastest ways of where people will be able to actually connect smart contracts to their wallets. And I'm excited to see if anybody tries that out. Some other projects like us at Flint and DC Spark, we're going kind of a different direction. Where instead of trying to focus on this, we're instead focusing on Solidity compatibility for the Cardano ecosystem. So that, you know, through our wallets, we'll be able to provide functionality for Solidity style smart contracts on the Cardano blockchain. And that's kind of our main focus. So, you know, there's different streams all being tackled kind of in parallel, but different teams. And so, you know, these will all eventually come out probably at different times. And because they're technical in nature, I'm sure nobody wants to commit to a specific date. But hopefully you can see there's kind of different approaches people are taking. And I'm excited to see which ones come out first and the different trade-offs each one has.
Thanks, Sebastian. What about with Daedalus and CC Wallet? Are there any similar plans to run local apps and the wallet connects local, or are you going to retrieve it from a centralized server? How's that going to work?
So for CC Wallet, I have to say that our small team didn't look into smart contracts yet. We are waiting for solutions that Sebastian just mentioned to have an easier time to implement it. We will certainly go for a browser extension as well at some point, just to reassure people that it's all running locally. And for smart contracts, I guess we are talking with some of the swaps that are coming up on the chain, and they will hopefully also have some technical insights for us how to connect to their platforms.
All right. Thank you, Marcel. Now, I do have to say you did a great job displaying native tokens in CC Wallet. So when I want to display native tokens, I'm now going to CC Wallet. When I want to see my reward history, look in Yoroi, because you can put the same wallet in the same, you can put the same wallet in the same browser, right? Yoroi is really good at displaying reward history. And then Daedalus is all around just fun for me to play with. And for me, for some strange reason, Daedalus tends to be a little bit more reliable connecting sometimes, especially near the turn of the epoch. But that's just in my particular location with my internet connection. So a little bit more about Daedalus. Are there plans for a Daedalus Light wallet in the future?
Yeah, no, so as I was alluding to a little bit earlier, we do think that the full node wallet is a bit more for enterprise applications, or at least that's the direction that we want to take that in. So we do want to make sure that for our current users of Daedalus, we are also getting like a lighter wallet experience. So there is a keynote talk that I'm doing about the IOG Lite wallet experience, and we'll be sort of like displaying some of the features that are coming out in there. So it's probably best to watch that one. But yes, there is definitely a strategy to sort of merge all the, you know, products that IOG is working on the sort of one umbrella, and then allowing, you know, anybody to use that, and hopefully that will be an experience that is going to draw your attention, Rick.
Excellent. Thank you, Alex. So for the viewers, be sure to check out the other presentation at the Gogan Summit here that Alex will be providing more information there. So that would be great to get more details. Gentlemen, we covered pretty much everything we had on our list of items that we wanted to touch on. The background and staking with exchange or with wallets. What is the best wallet? We didn't really touch on what is the best wallet for NFTs yet, but that kind of goes with the tokens. Does anyone have an opinion? What do you think is the best wallet for NFTs so far? Is it Daedalus, CC Wallet, Nami Wallet, Yoroi? What do you think? That was one of our talking points, so you got to get your inputs in.
Well, what I can say from Yoroi perspective is that at the moment we are improving, and soon enough, like next week or the following one, we're going to be releasing a better way to really visualize your tokens and NFTs, and then additionally improving all the way that we are sending the different native tokens. That's in the short term. In a bit longer term, like, or midterm really, like in a month or so, we are doing a big redesign, as I'm talking in the presentation separately, where we're going to bring in like an NFT gallery and really a way to see your whole portfolio and be able to operate with all the native tokens, right? So we understand there is a huge push from the community with anything to do with NFTs and native tokens, really. Therefore, we have reacted and we are really improving the way we'll display those and really operate with them from a user perspective.
All right. Thank you, Sergio. And I'm glad I went through the summary here of our key points that we wanted to hit on. One of them I had missed was on ranking. So on ranking, the question was, how can we do better with ranking? Currently, Daedalus displays the stake pool rankings with the non-myopic method mathematics running in the background. And with Yoroi, it is pulling the data from ADA pools to get the ranking from there as well. So some of the key complaints I've heard from people with the ranking is that, especially in Daedalus, it'll cut off somewhere between 550 and 575. It'll stop ranking the pools. And then from there on, they all have the same number attached. For example, 575, and then they're all orange. They're like a really dark orange, meaning that they're not going to display. So that was one. And the other one is that there are wallets down below in Daedalus that fall into that above the 500 range. And it'll say that, what are the rewards for that wallet? And it will say the rewards are zero, when in fact those pools are actually providing rewards. Those are two of the most common complaints. So what are y'all's thoughts on ranking, and how can we do better?
So I think I'm considering this is definitely a complaint that we've seen in the community, and something that we've been trying to address within Daedalus. So it's probably important to realize that the non-myopic ranking function comes from the node, and as everybody knows, like, the node has been working really hard in order to deliver Gogan. But at the same time, we have been able to sneak in at least one of the promised features. So there's the desirability as addition to sort of like the non-myopic ranking. So that should be coming out Daedalus pretty soon. Again, it's of a technical nature, so we're not tying down to it yet, but it should be coming out pretty soon. And then at the same time, I believe there's another talk, which is not for me, about two new types of ranking functions. Now, one of the things that we have been talking about is like, okay, well, whatever ranking function you're going to create, like, somebody's going to be at the top and somebody's going to be at the bottom, and somebody's going to be unhappy. That's unfortunately the nature of the game, but I'm happy to hear different opinions about it.
Yeah, well, I like to expand on that, actually. From Yoroi, we're exploring two different paths. First of all, to really move from a ranking to more of a recommendation or score, similar to the, you know, some of the agencies do ratings, or really a rating, so that there is a clear criteria and there is not an actual ranking of top one and top 3,000, but there's actually different buckets and segments where you can fall in, right? And within those, like, you can go into more of a random selection or different ways to display them, right? So that there is no such a stake pool that falls really down below, right? That's one. But at the same time, we want to allow, and we are discussing it at the moment, the ability for some of those stake pools to promote themselves with an easy way to stake, right? So at the moment, they need to scroll down, or say their ticker to their, you know, to the Cardano holders. But the idea would be to really find a way to implement an easy way to stake and delegate to that given stake pool. Imagine on their website, if they have a website for the stake pool. So sort of having like a widget or a way to interact from that website or promotion or Telegram, wherever that is, and then find a way, in our case for Yoroi, to directly delegate, right? So that the entry point for the users is easier and they don't need to search or scroll down. So all the information could see it outside of Yoroi, but then integrate it down into Yoroi for the quick delegation from an estate pool perspective.
Yeah, I would like to add that I'm really looking forward to multi-delegation, where we can just choose certain pools of pools. And then this ranking problem won't be as huge as it is now. So if you are looking for charity pools that are just a list of 20 pools, then you can delegate to those. If you want OG pools that were here in the ITN, you can delegate to those pools. All of your ADA distributed on all those pools. So the ranking will get less significant in the future, and I'm looking forward to that.
On the front side, or is that something on the back end, or is it both? How's that going to work?
Yeah, we have to display the different pools you can choose from, and those portfolios, those are called portfolios, will have a certain weight on all of the single pools that are on that list, and your ADA will be distributed evenly onto those pools. The specification for that was done via a Cardano improvement proposal, and it's ready to be implemented. So we just, as a wallet ecosystem, just need to do that now.
Thank you, Marcel. That's excellent. So I guess the key focus there is to make sure it's easy for the delegators. Matthias, please.
Yeah, I was about to say, I think I know exactly where you came from, Rick, sorry, because you've been part of the ITN, so you've seen like all the Among Other nodes and whatnot, right? And there was this feature at the time where you could have multi-delegations done at the protocol level, which was a thing there, but that was not kept with the Haskell nodes in the end. And the reason for that is the amount of complexity it adds on the ledger, right? So at this stage, the multi-delegation is handled purely by the wallets. And it's a solution done by the wallet clients. In a way, it organizes the, you know, stake key management and how it chooses to create that portfolio and make sure that, you know, the right amount of stake is dedicated to the right stake pool. So that's sort of a shift of complexity onto the wallets, but that's for the best because then we keep the layer one, you know, less complicated and focused on, you know, managing smart contract, managing the ledger state, and making sure that, you know, it's all safe.
Okay, so that's more of a feature that could be implemented in any wallet if you keep it on the wallet side, and then the creators of the wallets have different methods they can use to present that to the users to allow them to select different groups of pools. Does anyone have a time horizon, maybe in the next year, by 2023, it's possible we could have multi-delegation? Because users are interested in that. Stake pool operators tend to be a little bit more vocal about things like ranking and multi-delegation, but I have heard from users who are interested in multi-delegation. Any time horizon on that or guesses?
Yeah, so if you want this to be implemented at the protocol level, the main thing is that the team at IOHK that's working on the core protocol was busy with Alonzo, right? So trying to add in another protocol feature would mean delaying the Alonzo release, which is not really something that we wanted to do. So now that we have Alonzo out the door, there's kind of more options that can be done. So if you want to kind of voice your opinion about, you know, what should be included in the next hard forks like Babbage, you know, now's the time to make these kind of Cardano improvement proposals. Now, obviously, these are fairly technical in nature. And so, unfortunately, it's hard for any, you know, person to come in and make these proposals without deep knowledge of mathematical specifications in Haskell. But, you know, part of, you know, the Cardano 2026 roadmap or whatever it's going to get called is trying to distribute the development of Cardano have it not just be HK, but, you know, have it be kind of a growing ecosystem of companies, you know, building out the ecosystem. And so if people want to, you know, be involved in that kind of process, if any companies are interested, now's the time to kind of get started. There's Catalyst and other funding methods in Cardano to, you know, basically get your company funded to do this kind of core development work. And, you know, IOHK and other companies in the Cardano ecosystem are more than happy to, you know, work with people on this.
Awesome. Thanks, Sebastian. I did not know that the next hard fork was called Babbage, I guess named for Charles Babbage. All right. So the last key point, and we are done here today, and that is the question was, how do we think wallets need to evolve to make crypto more available to the mass markets, or in other words, more user-friendly? So what are your takes on that? What do you have for us? How do we make it better?
Okay, maybe I will start, and maybe it's a controversial take on that, but I do think that wallets should stop trying to be too simplistic, right? In the same way, if you have your car and you have the car manual, you can deep dive into it and, you know, repair things yourself. Right, you just have to follow the instructions, right? And to use the car, you don't have to know how it works. But if you want to, you know, go underneath and do some of the stuff yourself, you still have the option to. And that's how you learn in the end, right? Like with any system. So I think on the long term, the wallet should give more and more control to users on how they can do things, how they can interact with every little components of their wallets, so that people can start, you know, learning a bit more about crypto. learning more how it works, how, you know, how things are behind the scene. So of course, by default, when you enter a wallet, you get some, you know, very simple interface. There is some handholding for you, and you know you get a soft onboarding into the process. But as you get to know more how things work, you want to, you know, dive a bit more into it, and you want to understand how it's happening, how things work. And I think it's important for people to understand, and that's the whole point of crypto in the end. You are in charge of your own credentials, of your own assets, of your own funds. So you got to have some level of understanding of how things are going, right? Otherwise, you're going to make mistakes. And that's the same question you asked earlier. How do you make wallets more secure? How do you prevent people from getting scammed? Well, you educate people, right? And you get to teach people how to take care of their assets, how their keys. And they don't have to understand how the protocol works on the, you know, nifty details. But at least, you know, they can steadily get to know how this whole machinery works and turn on more complex features as they advance. But that's only like my take on that.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we are actually at the end of our time. So I don't think we have the time to actually respond to this controversial comment right now.
Okay, thank you, Alex. On that note, we will be wrapping it up. So looking for, in the future, a little bit more simplicity with the user ability to turn on the more advanced features, similar to how Yoroi is now. It has the simple and advanced option. And as smart contracts and dApps continue to deploy, there will probably be features there where you can either hide or display things as needed. So that would be a great way moving forward, in my opinion. I really like that concept. Thank you for that, Matthias, Sergio, Alex, Marcel, Sebastian. Thank you, gentlemen, for being here today. Alex, I'm going to hand over the last words to you, sir. Wrap us up. What do you got for us?
The honor is great, Rick. Thanks. Yeah, no, I would like to thank all of our panelists for their great contributions and their insights. And I believe some of you even have like follow-up conversations and follow-up talks. So be sure to view those as well. And I hope everybody's having a great summit.